From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello and welcome to this JAMA podcast. I am Dr. Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Melanie Jay, who is Associate Professor of Medicine and Population Health at the New York University Grossman School of Medicine and at the Veterans Affairs. Dr. Jay is a physician scientist and a general internist, and today we'll be talking about Dr. Jay's narrative review published in JAMA on the management of obesity. Welcome, Dr. Jay.
Thank you so much for having me.
I want to start by talking about the prevalence of obesity in the United States and worldwide. The obesity is very common. And I wonder if you could just update us on where we are in terms of the prevalence and whether we've made any progress in slowing rates of obesity in the United States.
Certainly in the United States, the prevalence is very high. In 2020, Hales et al. Published that the obesity rates from 2017 to 2018 was 42.4%. And in 2019, Ward et al. Published projected obesity rates that they will be 49% by 2030, and it will be higher than 50% in 29 states. It is very high. It continues to increase. We really do not know exactly why. We think it has to do with our food environment, but there might be other environmental factors that contribute. Obesity is a chronic disease, and like any other chronic diseases, it is caused by an interaction with our genes and our environment, and certain behaviors play a role as well, but most of the factors are beyond the patient's control.
And your JAMA review focuses on five different categories of weight loss treatments, and they are behavioral methods, nutritional approaches, physical activity, medication, and bariatric procedures. And so I'm wondering, as a generalist, when a patient walks in with obesity, how do you go about selecting an initial treatment?
Right. This is a great question. And I think that we should start to consider, when choosing treatments for obesity, to do it in the way we do any other chronic disease. For instance, when I have a patient with hypertension, I counsel them about lifestyle modifications and medications. If the blood pressure is not severe, I might try lifestyle change for a little while and then have them come back and see. But a lot of times I'll start the medication in conjunction with lifestyle and do it concurrently because that has been shown to also be very effective. And medications generally for patients are more effective than the lifestyle. So when we talk about these five modalities, a lot of times we'll do them together. They're not just try one, then the other. Also, to consider that for obesity, by the time my patient has come and seen me, they've often tried many different diets and behavioral interventions. And usually we have a conversation and I take a shared decision-making approach to determine what would be best to try. A lot of times medication availability and coverage also play a big role. In the past, we did not have as many effective obesity medications, but now we do. And I think and hope that as more and more medications are approved to treat obesity and their safety and effectiveness really becomes undisputed, then more people will have access to them and they'll become more common.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the behavioral methods that you review in your manuscript. Can you tell us what are some key things that the generalist should know about using behavioral methods to treat obesity?
The guidelines and the evidence really show that if we're talking about lifestyle modification, it's usually much more effective to have an intensive program, so 14 or more sessions in 6 months. And usually we think of them being multi-component behavioral interventions that combine diet, physical activity, and then other behavioral modalities such as self-monitoring, such as keeping food diaries and self-weighing. And then they often bring in things like stress reduction, sleep hygiene, principles of motivational interviewing or cognitive behavioral treatment. And these kind of programs include the diabetes prevention program or the VA's MOVE program. These multi-component behavioral treatments tend to be the most effective, expect about 5% weight loss, and certainly they are shown to decrease risk of diabetes. But we also have to realize that they're hard to adhere to. up to half might not respond, and that weight regain is common.
And you mentioned sleep hygiene, and tell us what specifically about sleep is related to treating obesity.
A lot of this is associations. There's been a few studies that have shown that improving sleep helps with weight loss, but certainly we know that when people have poor sleep, including duration and quality, that you have increased cortisol levels, and that is associated with weight gain, and that people are hungrier if they don't sleep. Their ghrelin goes up and people become hungrier. So they incorporate a lot of times sleep hygiene into the treatment. It's also just good for overall health and quality of life. Also, people are much more likely to be able to adhere to major behavior changes if they've had enough sleep.
Your JAMA review talks about nutritional approaches. So is there an optimal diet for losing weight?
We are still trying to find, based on precision medicine, what diet or any treatment for that matter is going to be good for a given patient. And we're not there yet. So there are several diets that have been shown to work, especially when combined with calorie restriction. We talk about Mediterranean diet, low-fat diet, low-carb, DASH diet, etc. Some physicians do prescribe specific diets for patients. I don't do that as often unless a patient comes to me and says, I want to be on this diet. I usually work with a patient to determine what diet are you going to most likely adhere to. I also, when possible, refer them to dietitians because I don't have often enough time to really follow someone to reinforce healthy eating for whichever diet they're on. Usually, we're working on improving the overall dietary composition and reducing calorie intake. Dietary composition that we often work on is including more fruits and vegetables, more whole grains and lean proteins, and less refined carbohydrates, less sugar, less sweetened beverages, going to restaurants less, cooking more when possible, or at least making healthy choices if you have to go out and eat at restaurants. In a practical sense, given what we know about adherence to diets, I'm usually working on helping the patient improve to a diet or eating behaviors that they can stick to.
And how about physical activity, which is one of the methods you review in your JAMA article? How much physical activity is necessary to lose weight?
So in general, physical activity is not considered a standalone treatment. I see patients at the Veterans Affairs and at the VA because they have had so much training in physical activity and were probably quite fit when they were in the military. They really think that they just need to exercise to lose weight. Usually you get an average of 2 to 3 kilograms of weight loss, and that's with 150 to 300 minutes of moderate physical activity per week or 75 to 150 minutes of vigorous physical activity. And of course, this should be combined with resistance training. So for weight loss itself, I don't see it as important as diet and other behavior change modalities. However, physical activity is incredibly important for reducing visceral fat, for improving function, for improving well-being, for cardiovascular risk reduction. And it also seems to be very important for weight maintenance. And for weight maintenance, we recommend greater than 200 minutes per week. We do counsel patients about physical activity, but again, it's not a standalone treatment.
So I want to spend some time talking about medication treatment of obesity, and I'd like to focus on the glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonists, such as semaglutide. So which patients are candidates for the GLP-1 receptor agonists? Can you just talk a little bit about them, how effective they are, what adverse effects they have, and who should receive them?
So semaglutide is a weekly injection and is more effective than liraglutide, which is a daily injection, but both are FDA approved for weight loss in patients with obesity. Both were first developed as diabetes medications because they stimulate insulin release and promote glucose control. Both also suppress appetite centrally and delay gastric emptying, leading to decreased calorie intake. And people find that they are less hungry, they feel full after smaller meals, and they don't think about food as much. For semaglutide, we have the STEP trial. So in step 3, semaglutide plus lifestyle treatment led to around about a 15% reduction in weight. Compare that to the trials of liraglutide, which are closer to 8%. So in terms of which patients are eligible, for medications in general, we say that patients are eligible if their body mass index is 30 and above, or they have a 27 and above with comorbidities. Most patients with obesity can use these GLP-1 receptor agonists. They have few drug interactions. They can be used in kidney disease and heart failure. There are very few people who can't use them. I won't use them to anyone who has a risk of pancreatitis. There's a theoretical risk of thyroid cancer. So if someone has multiple endocrine neoplasia too, or a family history of medullary thyroid cancer, you probably would avoid it. In general, most patients are eligible who have obesity, and they have to be titrated. You have to start at low doses and then titrate up. For semaglutide, you titrate up every 4 weeks. So starting at 0.25 and titrating all the way up to 2.4. Although in practice, a lot of times we will titrate it more slowly. And if someone's doing well on a lower dose, you might keep them on that dose because they'll have less side effects and they're still losing weight. Side effects, though, are something that has to be managed. I mean, most patients get some sort of GI side effect, at least in the beginning, although a lot of times it goes away. So it includes nausea and vomiting or constipation. And these can be managed with conservative measures or by staying at a lower dose for longer. There are rare serious side effects like bowel obstruction and pancreatitis. And then with rapid weight loss, gallbladder disease is always a possibility. But in general, they're fairly well tolerated. We haven't rolled them out because they're so hard to get these days and they're not covered by a lot of insurance companies. We're not rolling them out in primary care, and a lot of doctors still can't prescribe them. And so we don't know yet how to best use them in primary care, what systems need to be in place to help patients titrate up to manage the side effects. And I really think it's going to take like a team approach to manage patients on these medications, ensure kind of long-term adherence.
How about tirzepatide? Can you talk about that a bit?
So tirzepatide combines the GLP-1 receptor agonist that we just talked about with something we call GIP, or glucose-dependent insulinotropic polypeptide. You can see why I prefer GIP. This is FDA approved for diabetes and is expected to be approved for obesity before the end of the year. The SURMOUNT study showed that you had a 21% weight loss with patients with obesity. That was SURMOUNT 1. SURMOUNT 3 was just presented this month at Obesity Week, which took people who participated in a 12-week intensive lifestyle program and lost on average 6.9% body weight and then randomized them to either tirzepatide versus placebo. And they found that the tirzepatide group lost an additional 21% at 72 weeks, whereas the placebo group gained 3.3%. So it's starting to get close to what we see with bariatric surgery. And really, in the next few years, we're going to see more combination medications. Like currently, there are phase 1 and or phase 2 trials of a medicine called retatrutide or triple G, which also takes the GLP-1 RA plus the GIP and adds also a glucagon receptor agonist. You're going to see medications that combine the GLP-1 RAs with other things like amylin analogs, and myostatin inhibitors are being tested. So we're going to have more and more effective choices for our patients in the next few years.
If you do not use either a GLP-1 receptor agonist or one of the newer drugs like tirzepatide, do you have a second line medication that you typically prescribe for obesity if one of those are not an option?
There are a bunch of other FDA-approved medications for weight loss. You have phentermine-topiramate combination, which is also called Qsymia. We talked about liraglutide. There's a medicine that combines naltrexone-bupropion, which is also called Contrave. Those are two other medications. And then there are things that we do that are kind of off-label. Metformin in some patients gets 5% weight loss, and certainly a lot of patients have prediabetes, so it's a really good medication to begin with. Some of these medications, like combined combination of phentermine topiramate, you can also use those medications alone, and same with naltrexone bupropion. So a lot of times it depends on availability and coverage. We still, as I said, we don't have a precision approach where we can say, oh, this patient has these markers of disease, so they're more likely to respond to this medication. I do take into consideration how the medications work and what other comorbidities the patient has. So for instance, if someone has migraines, I might be more likely to use a phentermine topiramate because topiramate has been known to prevent migraines, for instance. Or if there seems to be kind of an addictive component and they don't qualify for a GLP-1 receptor agonist, I might do the naltrexone bupropion. So at this point, there's not a good science to say like you should use one versus the other. And a lot has to do with what's available and the other medicines patients are taking.
How about bariatric procedures? Where do they fit into the treatment for obesity?
Bariatric procedures have been around for a long time. And a lot of the medications that we developed came from our understanding of how these metabolic surgeries work. The American Society of Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery now recommends bariatric surgery for patients with a body mass index of 35 kilograms per meter squared or greater, and also to be considered for people with metabolic disease and a body mass index greater than or equal to 30 who have had a trial of non-surgical therapy. And the two most common types of bariatric procedures are laparoscopic sleeve gastrectomy, where 85% of the stomach is removed, and we can expect about a 25% weight loss at 12 months with that procedure. And then Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, where the expected weight loss is 30%. And these are very safe procedures. There are some complications, and patients do have to be followed. So early complications include anastomotic leaks and stenosis and some bleeding, but it's pretty rare. And then late complications, there can be internal hernias or ulcers, marginal ulceration. Vitamin deficiencies are really the big long-term thing, especially for the gastric bypass. And so vitamin supplementation and screening for vitamin deficiencies becomes important going forward. But bariatric surgery has been shown to decrease mortality. I just saw a study showing decreased cancer risk over 10 years. So these have been around a long time and they are very effective.
Thank you for this really informative discussion on treatment of obesity. Is there anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, there's a really important issue when we talk about obesity that I want to make sure that we talk about, which is that it is a stigmatized condition. And that much of the public and healthcare providers still view it as a behavioral disorder and seeing it as being the patient's fault. However, as I discussed, it is a disease. And like any other chronic disease, it's caused by interaction between genetics and environment and personal behaviors. And we also give patients medications that cause weight gain. And so telling a patient when they come to you that it isn't their fault and that you are there to help them can be so important. And right now, it is severely undertreated. Less than 2% of eligible patients get anti-obesity medications. And so I'm really interested in how do we expand access to treatment, which is currently not covered by Medicare and some other insurance companies. And we also have to make sure as healthcare providers that we are educated in how to provide obesity care and that, again, we do not shame and blame our patients. And the good news is that we now have so many effective treatments for our patients than we did just a few years ago. And we need more research to figure out how to best expand treatment in primary care and through subspecialists, because even primary care doctors alone are not going to be able to treat all the patients with obesity who need it. And we really want to work with our interprofessional teams to really improve access since so many people need treatment.
Thank you for listening. This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com.